All right. Tonight we'll be preaching part one of a message entitled The Nothings of Ignorance as we continue the Nothing series through the Bible. So part one, The Nothings of Ignorance. So we're going to pray and we'll get into this. Father, thank you for the evening. Now, Lord, as we deal with this topic of ignorance tonight, help us to glean some important truths that will help us to learn, to grow, to improve in our Christian life. Father, if there's one here tonight that does not know about your salvation and doesn't know you, we pray that they would be saved tonight. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Have you ever been in a situation where you were ignorant about what to do, what to say, or did not understand what was happening or what someone was saying? I've been there and done that, especially in my high school trigonometry and physics classes. Those were tough courses. I did great in algebra, straight A's in that. But when I came to trigonometry and physics, that was a different chapter in my life, and thank God that chapter is over. I've also been in church services overseas where the pastor spoke in another language, and I did not have a clue of what he was saying at all. There was no interpreter provided for me. I don't like my ignorance. Can you relate to that? Say amen. Ignorance is humiliating because of the lack of knowledge. Ignorance makes you feel helpless or insecure because you lack understanding about a matter. Ignorance is horrifying, especially when you or your loved one are lost somewhere or you are faced with an emergency on how to help someone who is injured or perhaps someone who is dying. Ignorance can be high-priced or expensive when you lose or spend money that did not need to be spent if you only have the right knowledge, the wisdom, or the training. Ignorance is hurtful when you say or do things to others that hurt them. Jesus proclaimed on the cross the ignorance of those who crucified him. He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." As I continue to age, I continue to discover more and more my ignorance on some matters. The older I get, the more I realize I don't really hardly know anything when I discover the vastness of the universe. God's creation and mystery of knowing and understanding God, it bothers me because I want to know him more and more each day. I can relate to what the Lord said in the book of Isaiah, who said, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." Isaiah 55, 8 and 9. I don't want to be ignorant. I want to learn. In fact, if someone is speaking about something that I don't have a clue about what they're talking about, if I don't understand what they're talking about, I will not pretend to know what they are talking about. I will go ahead and ask them questions and ask them to explain to me what they are saying. I will let people teach me. This is how I learn, and it's how you will learn too. I'm not in the best business of trying to impress somebody, especially when I don't know what's going on. I want to know what's going on. It is my ignorance that drives me to spend long hours in my office as I study the scriptures. I want to know and understand God's word, but I also want God to use my preaching to make the scriptures understandable to those who listen to or read what I am preaching so that they can apply the scriptures in their own lives so that they can grow in the Lord. That's what I want. I want the lost sinner to understand the gospel so he or she will be saved and know Christ as their Savior. That was Paul's desire too. He said, now I would not have you ignorant brethren that oftentimes I purposed to come unto you but was let hitherto, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles. Romans 1:13. Now, when we look through the Bible, we find several insights about the ignorance of people. Number one, unsaved sinners are ignorant about the Lord Jesus Christ. Ephesians 4:18, having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart. Sometimes you just want to shake the eyeballs out of people when you're trying to tell them about Jesus Christ. Well, that's not really going to do them a lot of good. You need to be patient with them. They're ignorant, just like at one time you were ignorant before you were saved. Ignorance about the Lord and His Word lead to destruction. Hosea 4, verse 6. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee. That thou shalt be no priest to me, seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children. Number three, sometimes we are ignorant about what to pray in our life. Can you say hello on that one? Romans 8:26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. I don't know about you, but I thank God that the Spirit of God is praying for me when I don't have a clue on what to pray. He knows what our needs are, and he's got a direct line to heaven with the Father and the Son. Number four, we are ignorant and lack wisdom in some matters, but also have a remedy for that need in our life. James got in on this, and he said in James 1:5, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. Thank God you can ask him for wisdom in your life. We are ignorant about the works and the ways of God. Ecclesiastes 11:5. As thou knowest not what is the way of the Spirit, nor how the bones do grow in the womb of her that is with child, even so thou knowest not the works of God who maketh all. There's a lot of stuff that God does, folks, that we just can't figure it out. We don't have a clue what he's doing. We just know he's doing his own thing. And he can do his own thing because he's God. Number six, we are ignorant about our time of death. Ecclesiastes 9:12. For a man also knoweth not his time, as the fishes that are taken in an evil net, and as the birds that are caught in the snare, so are the sons of men snared in an evil time when it falleth suddenly upon them. By the way, because you don't know when you're going to die, you better be ready for it. Are you ready if your life ends tonight? That's a good question, because your life could end tonight. And usually when death strikes, it strikes when you least expect it. That deer jumps out at your car, gets in an accident. That driver starts driving down your lane of the highway on the interstate. I've had that happen to me three times. That's a scary thought. And not a scary thought, it's just a scary experience when you see somebody going down your side of the interstate because they took the wrong exit. You know what? We are also ignorant about some of the things in our future. Proverbs 27:1, boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. We are ignorant about God's course and plan for our lives sometimes. We may not understand all things that happen to us. Do you understand everything that happens to you? I don't. But we do know that God is watching over us, because he said so, and that's good enough for me. God does give us insights about his will for us. He gives direction through answered prayer and the scriptures, but yet some things are still a mystery to us. Proverbs 20:24. Man's goings are of the Lord. How can a man then understand his own way? Sometimes we don't understand our own way. Sometimes we don't know why the Lord allows things to happen in our lives. That's where we're just going to have to trust him. I think of Job, who said this. Job said, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. This message is about the nothings of ignorance. We will examine verses that provide insights about the nothings that are the result of ignorance or associated with ignorance. We will begin in the oldest book of the Bible. So take your Bible. Let's go to the book of Job, chapter number 8. Job chapter number 8. We see, first of all tonight, the ignorance from the shadow and swiftness of our lives. Job 8, verse 9. For we are but of yesterday and know nothing, because our days upon earth are a shadow. Job has gone through one nightmare after another. Satan has unleashed his venom, his violence, and his viciousness upon this dear man. He lost his health, his possessions, and all of his children have died from a terrible storm or tornado. Job was visited by older friends who tried to persuade him that he must have done something wrong and had wickedness in his life based on the conclusions and wisdom from the ancients. Bildad argued that sinners suffer and the righteous are the ones that are blessed. This teaching has been passed down from generation to generation. He told Job his suffering was not God's fault. It was Job's fault that he was suffering. Well, I'm sure that was real encouraging for Job. There are some important principles that we can glean from this guy, Bildad. Some of what he said does have merit, but some of his conclusions were not accurate. They were off target. Bildad stated in verse 9 that we know nothing. In this message, we will look at the nothings of ignorance. Why do we know nothing? Now, what is this all about? Well, number one, we know nothing because of our incomplete knowledge. For we are but of yesterday and know nothing. In comparison to those who lived in the past, Bildad believed that the wisdom of the ancient ones was indisputable. These were folks who lived for hundreds of years. For example, Methuselah, he had 969 birthday candles on his birthday cake. I mean, he just went ahead and burnt the thing to a crisp, I'll tell you what. 969 years old. Oh, preacher, come on. Nobody can live that long. Well, God said he was 969 years old. I believe that. The lifespan of the ancients gave them the opportunity to gain more knowledge. Compared to the shortened lives that people lived in Bildad's day, Bildad assumed that the knowledge of men in his time was inferior to the ancients who lived longer than they lived. He believed that Job's knowledge was not sound at all, because he was not one of the ancients. He also believed that Job was ungodly and was being judged by God because Job had evidently done something wrong. Bildad thought he knew what he was talking about, but in reality, he didn't know anything. Bildad knew nothing because his knowledge of the situation was incomplete. He did not know or understand what was really going on with Job, with Satan, and with God. God rebuked the friends of Job for what they did and said to Job. Bildad's reasoning was not totally sound because wisdom is not totally based on the years that a person lives. Age is not the determining factor of having wisdom in your life, having understanding, or having knowledge. In spite of the age of people before the Genesis flood, God had to destroy the world because of man's foolishness and his wickedness. The age of the people did not help them to be wise at all. Even today, I have witnessed the actions and thinking of some old people that are absolutely foolish, ludicrous, divisive, and destructive. A bunch of these folks work in Washington, D.C. right now, and several state capitals in the United States of America. These people claim to have it all because they're wise and old, but I tell you what, as far as I'm concerned, they're nuts. They're nuts. Well, let's move on. Amen. The true source of wisdom and knowledge is found in a person's relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. That is why Noah and his family survived the flood, because of his relationship with God. The Bible says that Noah walked with God. What a statement. He feared or revered the Lord. Proverbs 9:10 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding." Proverbs 1:7, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction." Well, Job was a man who had understanding, wisdom, and knowledge and integrity because Job had a right relationship with God. My question tonight is this: Do you have a good, close relationship with the Lord, the Savior of the world? I hope you do. Job feared the Lord. His relationship and righteousness were so great that God pointed out Job's integrity to Satan. He said, "If you want to pick on somebody and see just how tough you are, go check out Job." Wow. Job 1:8, "And the Lord said unto Satan, Hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth?" Boy, what a testimony. "A perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil." That was God's opinion of Job. I hope that God has a good opinion of me and of you. I hope that the way that we live pleases the Lord. Job 2:3, "And the Lord said unto Satan, Hast thou considered my servant Job, that there's none like him in the earth? A perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil, and still he holdeth fast his integrity. Although thou movest me against him to destroy him without cause." Even when Satan bullied Job, Job held fast his integrity. God directed Satan to test Job, to show Satan that his power was not as great as he assumed. The book of Job is all about the war that Satan waged against Job and also the victory of Job. It records in the last chapter the knowledge, the wisdom and blessing that Job gained through the fiery trials that he went through in his life. Job 42:1, then Job answered the Lord and said, I know that thou canst do everything and that no thought can be withholden from thee. Job 42:10, and the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Also the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. You know, we see something else here tonight. We know nothing because of our imperfect bodies. How many of you kind of, as you get older, you start feeling the aches and pains a little bit more? How many of you wonder where you're going and you can't remember where you're going? Huh? How many of you have to write down what you were told or what you were going to do, and then you forget where you wrote it down? Or you forget it before you write it down. Listen, I tell you what, it's horrifying. You know, it says, our days upon earth are a shadow. A single person's knowledge or a single generation's wisdom is limited due to the brevity of life. Even though the people of Job's day were still living to ages of 200 years, this was but a shadow compared to the 900-year lifespans of the patriarchs who lived before the Genesis flood. Bildad was right when he spoke of our lives being a shadow. Life is swift. It's fragile. And we are so sinful. Yes, we are like a shadow. David said, man is like to vanity. His days are as a shadow that passeth away. Psalm 144, verse 4. Our imperfect bodies limit our knowledge in some ways. Being a shadow reminds us of several important truths that we need to know and that we need to remember. Number one, the shadow reminds us of our corruption. Shadows are dark. That is the nature of the human race. Without the Lord in a person's life, he or she walks in spiritual darkness. If you do not know the Lord as your Savior tonight, you are walking in the dark. You are walking in darkness. That's what God says. We are all sinners. The Bible makes that clear. The shadow of sin hovers over mankind. Jack Beeman said, my heart is the very dunghill of the devil, and it is no easy work to wrestle with him on his own chosen ground. But we wrestle with him on that ground. I must, and the whole of my life, to that end. Oh, this flesh, this fleshly corrupt nature we have. Thank God for the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul expressed his frustration with his flesh in Romans 7. He says, the good stuff I want to do, I don't do. And the stuff I don't want to do, that's what I do. He was upset. But then he ends it all by saying, I thank God for the grace of God and the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You know, the start of a shadow is always at the base of the object. Man's shadow began at the base with the first man in the Garden of Eden with Adam's sin. Paul said in Romans 5:12, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. And so death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. You know, shadows form from the opposite direction, Front light goes to back shadows. Light on the right shadows on the left. Man's nature is to go the opposite direction from God. That's our nature. When Adam did this in the Garden of Eden, the rest of humanity was affected by his rebellion. Shadows are created by an object blocking the path of the light source. The sin of man broke his fellowship with the Lord, who is the light of the world, the Bible says. That is why men have a shadow nature. Thank God, however, the darkness can be dispelled by the light, the Lord Jesus Christ. Christ is the one that restores our fellowship with God. John said in John 8:12, "Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life." Paul said in Ephesians 5:8, "For we were sometimes darkness, but now are you the light of the Lord. Walk as children of light." You know what? May we seek to know Him who in many ways we are ignorant of in so many different ways. And not only that, may we seek to never be ignorant of His love, to grow in our love, our devotion, and dedication to Him.